2, Gospel of John, first chapter. And we are presently discussing verse 6 through 8. And in that process, we are going to pull some other scriptures out of the first chapter so that we will actually be progressing. And beginning in verse 6, there was a man sent from God. His name was John. The same came for a witness, to bear witness of the light, that all men through him might believe. He was not that light, but was sent to bear witness of that light. And there's two particular words there. Bear witness, to bear witness. When it speaks of being a witness, of course, and I always allude to this, it is not speaking of witnessing, it is speaking of being an eyewitness. And there are so many people that do witnessing that are not eyewitnesses, that not seeing what they need to see. Yep. They are eyewitnesses. And, somebody said, well, I have a hard time witnessing. But, most people don't have a hard time talking about things they know about. There's things they don't know about, they have a hard time. And, you will find witnessing whether, what is the difference between witnessing and sharing? Well, you know what? In a lot of ways, there's no difference. Maybe the subject matter becomes more of something to win somebody's, win them for the Lord. But really, if you're sharing, you're talking about the Lord, you're talking about what you've seen, you're sharing from the scriptures, and if you're witnessing, you're talking about the Lord, you're talking about what you've seen, you're sharing from the scriptures. I mean, there's not a lot of difference. But we all choke up or something, We just, what we need to learn to do is share what we've seen. And if you haven't seen it yet, don't share it. Not only don't share it, don't try to be it. Now, once again, when I say don't share it, I mean don't put yourself under pressure to feel you have to share that with somebody else. If you're using the sword of the Spirit or something like that, that's very different than putting yourself under pressure. And then the thought of bearing witness. This is something that I seem to see very little of, and that is people that actually bear witness. They don't bear it. They don't carry it. They talk about Jesus if they want. They share if they want. There's not a bearing, almost a bearing of the cross in the process. Where this is, Jesus said this when he was 12 years old, I must be about my Father's business. It's like everything's optional to us because we're living here. We live in this world. We can choose. We want to leave the doors open for lots of fun and lots of times and lots of this and that. And but to bear witness is something that that I can assure you, if you come to the reality, it never leaves you. Now, that doesn't mean you witness all the time, but it never leaves you. There is, maybe there's some truth to this and alluded to Jesus' words, take my yoke. It is something now that you are intimately joined to that is, as we will see in this class, Lord willing, that is greater than you. Therefore, you are, the less is blessed of the greater. That's what it says. And this is greater than you. And so you must bear it. You must carry it. You must hold and be responsible for and see to it as much as in you is, that the witness, that the true light be seen. That the true light be seen. You know, a lot of people join churches and they join denominations and they join groups and they say, oh, I believe that. I believe this, I believe that. But you see, that's one of the, almost one of the proofs that they haven't really seen the true light. The same came for a witness, to bear witness of the light. It doesn't mean that they don't understand the basic tenets of the faith, the basic tenets of what that group believes. They probably spouse as good as anybody. But there is, for those who have seen it, you are intimately joined with it. You cannot, forever, throughout all eternity, you have seen that which is from the beginning. You've seen that which is before you. You've seen that which is preferred before you, and to you it is preferred before you. You find it easy to share that. And that was one of the things I wanted to get into because this is talking about this witness of John. John came to bear witness of the light. And there's a couple of places where he gives this witness. He gives what's in his heart in relationship to this witness. And they're all in the first chapter, verse 15, verse 27, and verse 30. And they're all very similar. They're all instances where he's given the opportunity to bear witness, and you get to see how he bears witness, that he is not just witnessing. First verse 15, and Luke says, John bore witness of him, and cried, say, he could have said, and he bore witness of him and said, but it says, John bore witness of him and cried, say, this was he of whom I spoke. He that cometh after me is preferred before me, for he was before me. Now look at verse 27, another verse. He it is who, coming after me, is preferred before me, whose shoe latchet I am not worthy to lose. Now look at verse 30. And this is he of whom I said, after he cometh, a man who is preferred before me. You see that three different times he uses this terminology in his witness. He is bearing witness. And the way that you can tell that he is born up under this thing, that he is bearing witness and not just witnessing, is the way that he does it. It's not like everybody else. It is, he specifically, three times, every time the subject comes up, he must say almost, he is preferred before. Now, God knows, I don't know a single Christian that wouldn't say amen to that. And yet, the truth that I'm talking about, and I'm sure we must not have it as well as John had it. So it's not even the truth I'm talking about. The truth that he must have known is so far beyond us, you know, because it is totally affected his tongue. But his tongue is only affected because his mind is affected. His mind is affected because his spirit has been affected. It's reached that far. Okay, I think our spirits have been affected. But it's worked all the way out. It's working out of it. I wrote in my notes, I wrote as if John, I guess, speaking as if I were him. He is before me. He is before me. And I wrote, Jesus needs to be before self. Jesus needs to be before self. He needs to be before me. And he is preferred before me. By who is he preferred before me? By the Father. Because he is the same. He is the complete, he's the logo, the complete thought and concept of God. So he is preferred before him. He is so pleased with Jesus this is, now this is referring back to John. He is so pleased with Jesus that he doesn't go to anyone else after Jesus. He just declares Jesus. Jesus is the Lord. Jesus is the Lord. And there's several different ways that he can put that. Jesus is preferred before self. Jesus is preferred before me. Jesus is before me. And Jesus is before me. Because if you prefer him before you, then Jesus will be before you. Do you understand what I mean? He will be in front of you. He will be before you. Why? Because where your treasure is, there will your heart be. You will not find it difficult to keep Jesus ahead of you, ahead of self. You will not find it difficult to do these things. And then I put, the Father is pleased with him before me. He is before me. To me, he is preferred before me. So we are to be accepted in him. Then, you are equal or whatever. You know what I'm saying? You're one with, but not equal, but you're one with, because you're in the beginning. He came after me, and he comes after me if I put self first. But he is before me, for the Father has always put him first. Regardless of what order I put him in, the Father will always put him first. The Father will always, and that will never change, because to the Father, he is complete. He is the same. And the Father does not change his viewpoint. We live here, and we assume, and we judge, and we do this, but the Father never changes. From my viewpoint, I come first. From his viewpoint, Jesus is first. Then I was thinking, this spirit that John had, where he came, see, this set him apart from other ministers. And you got to look at this. Jesus has not even come on the scene in actuality yet. And yet there is this one who finds himself. I don't know that he got a rebellious streak and separated from the religious system and said, I hate religion. And it's all bad. And, you know, I think that life, because he came to bear witness of the light, that light began to divide central from spirit realm. And he found himself, and I believe that's almost a good way of putting it. You find yourself not flowing with the religious crowd or not, but there's no, you know, there are people who are just rebellious, and they want to rebel against the religious crowd. They want to rebel against this and that. And to feed that is to feed rebellion. I don't care if it builds your group and puts others down and makes people want to join with you and get a bunch of what some might call radical Christians. That's not what I call it. I call those rebellious Christians. But and you foster, and if not foster, you feed. You go beyond fostering. You feed that rebellion in them, and they'll turn around and rend you. Eventually, you feed it strong enough, and the right circumstances come up, and that rebellion will rebel against you. You know what I mean? You want Christ in them. That's what you want. Yeah. And if it separates you, like the man who was blind, and Jesus touched him, and the Pharisees found him and said, you know, man, don't go with him. Don't trust that Jesus, you know. You know, he's doing stuff he shouldn't be doing, whatever. He's going, look, man, all I know is I was blind, now I see. Okay, he wasn't being rebellious against the system. He was pro-Jesus, not anti-anything. And if in the process of going after Jesus, you find yourself being separated from friends, you find yourself being separated from religious groups or this or that, then that's okay, because you're not trying to do that. That's not your spirit. Your spirit is to know the Lord. And John found himself a very different kind of minister, but I don't think there was a pattern. I said I'm comparing myself after this kind of ministry because I don't like the way most of the ministries work. I think he just went after the Lord, and I think that any group that really is of God will do that, and other groups will see the Lord and see the success, because there's usually a certain amount of some kind of success with that, and they try to copy that group, and they don't go after the Lord. It's a real common path. But I think John just simply separated himself, or actually went after the Lord, and in so doing found himself. And he's out there bearing witness now. This man, you know, he didn't sound like all the other teachers and Pharisees and scribes and all that. He was very different because he had conviction and he had something that they didn't have. They could speak of God and, anything. But it was not the same. It was not what? The same. It wasn't the same. And that's the thing that makes the difference. So, and you talk to him and he goes, well, let me tell you, there's one that is before me. There's one that is preferred before me. And it works in you. You read things like Philippians chapter 2. Try doing this scripture here without the truth. Philippians 2, verse 3. 3 and 4. And take it as real as you can take it. You know what I mean? Don't fool around. Let nothing be done through strife or vain glory. Doesn't have to be strife. It can be self-seeking. It's one way that we get lifted up is we put other people down. Let nothing be done through strife or vainglory, but in lowliness of mind, let each esteem others better than themselves. Look not every man on his own things, but every man also on the things of others. So you begin to see a tremendous task here. Wait a minute. To let nothing be done through these things, but in lowliness of mind to esteem others better than yourself. Verse 2 says, fulfill ye my joy. In other words, fulfill the joy. There's a joy in Christ, but he'd like to fulfill. The fulfillment brings manifestation. Manifestation brings the fulfillment, the total fulfillment, by the way. But anyway, fulfill ye my joy that ye may be like-minded, having the same love, being of one accord, of one mind. Let nothing be done. Okay, now that's almost impossible in the natural. But folks, that's the Bible. That's your Bible, and that's my Bible. And I say that's not only not impossible, I say that's the norm. I say that's how it's supposed to be. I say that's what God's got in mind. And look in James. Look at James. Okay, along in that same spirit, I don't want you to hear commandments. I want you to catch that he's laying down a spirit that fulfills this. He's asking the question in verse, this is James chapter 3, verse 13. He asks a question. Who is a wise man and endued with knowledge among you? Is there one? Let him show out of a good life. That's the word there should be translated life. Out of a good life, his works, not works alone, but in a certain spirit with meekness of wisdom. But if you have bitter envying and strife in your hearts, glory not, and I love this, and lie not again. Don't lie to yourself. And especially don't lie against the truth. This wisdom descended not from above. And John said in several different places, he is not only before me, but he is from the above. This wisdom descended not, is not from the same, is not from that which was in the beginning. This wisdom doesn't come from there. it's not emanating from that. It hasn't found, it is not dwelling in light where there is no darkness. It is dwelling in darkness and comparing darkness to darkness and coming up with something that is of a higher standard in the sense realm, in the darkness realm. See, we say sense realm, and you still can compare. You call it darkness realm, and there's all you're doing is comparing darkness with darkness. This wisdom descended not from above, but is earthly, sensual, and the word sensual there in the Greek is soulish. The next word, demonical. Demonical. Earthly, soulish, earthly being of the world system, of this earth, of this realm, if you will. Soulish, demonical. They all operate in the same realm, the sense realm. You cut the realm off. See, most of us are trying to cut demons off. You cut operating in that realm, you cut everything off. See, you heard a little phrase, it's just a phrase, it's changed realm. It's God's answer. What he has, what he said, what he holds as true, is going to be, it's always been true before there was anything. It's going to be true long after it's over. Christ is going to be all and in all. For those who have found him, they will rejoice at his coming. For those who love him will rejoice at his appearance. For when he shall appear, they shall be like him, whether it's by revelation or the second time in the year. When he shall appear, they shall rejoice, because that is their identification. In the meantime, if they haven't fully seen, they're content to be hid. They're content to be hid. For where envying and strife are, there is confusion and every evil work. The Lord talked to me once and said, every evil work, not just a few things. Every evil work. Why? Because if you're in the sense realm, the door is open to any and everything. I don't care. You know, we say, I'm not doing as bad as I used to. Let me tell you, we are not of this world. We are in it, but we are not of it. I know that I've talked to many of you at times, and you don't understand, because I'll talk and you'll say, well, I used to be in this sense realm, and I had these five areas here in the sense realm, and now I only have two, and these areas right here are no longer operated by that. I'm actually operated by this, now I'm only having two. Okay, now, all right, I understand the progress. I do thank the Lord for that. But you must see, as I see, and I can't even imagine how the Lord sees, that as long as there is access, God, if you will, every still has access, because this is the door. Okay?
And Adam is a figure who was to come, and just as the same has many different manifestations, Adam is Adam, whether it's good manifestations or bad manifestations.
Right.
It's the same. That's why it's open for every evil work, is for as long as there's any of that old man left, there's potential for everything.
Right. Well, and another truth that I found to be true is that a lot of what we think we've dealt with, like these three that are gone, are not actually gone. We have this amazing resiliency, the old man does, to kind of circumvent this area, but it really moves over into a more self-righteous or religious area. It's like water. We change from water to water vapor. Or to ice. But it's still the basic, it's still the basic thing. But we don't really notice that. Now I want you to think about this, and this isn't a problem, but I'm going to just tell it to you like this, because one day you might appreciate it. There's this realm and this realm, and if you ever get a hold of this, it will basically be like this. This realm, no working, I'm in this realm. Now, I know that you don't, because you're still in this realm trying to straighten up the little areas, see all these little things in here? You're in there trying. kind of bringing us down to those areas, and you feel like, look, I have dealt with this, right? But how in truth can you fully, okay, can I put it that way, in truth, fully deal with this? If you don't deal with it through the cross that takes care of this and brings you into a whole other realm. Alright, Jerry?
Okay, you're saying a couple of different things here.
Yes, I am.
Because I've heard you say, personally, that there's many areas that you need to grow in.
Absolutely.
But what you're saying when you say that is that there's areas that you need to grow in by taking care of the cross. But what you're saying that you've heard us say is that we're not taking care of the cross, we're trying to beat it down here.
Okay. Yes. Okay. Now, see, it sounds, you know, okay. If somebody said, well, you know, it's not all settled down here in this realm, I still have things or whatever, then isn't he denying the cross? No, not necessarily. Turn to Galatians chapter 5. This is still scriptures that are trying to bring out this spirit that I'm talking about, okay? This is still along the same flow. I'm only bringing up things that are going with the flow. The things that Jerry brought out are not contrary to that. But I may jump from that a little bit, so I want you to help me to try to answer that. Galatians chapter 5, verse 26. Let us not be desirous of vainglory, provoking one another, envying one another. Okay, isn't this in the flow of he is preferred before me, and then the scripture in Philippians, and the scripture in James, you know, esteem others better than yourself. This wisdom has lowliness of mind. The other wisdom is demonical, it is sensual, it is earthly. Okay? This says, let us not be desirous of vainglory, provoking one another. Okay, now back up and look at this scripture, verse 25. If we live in the Spirit, let us also walk in the Spirit. Alright, now this jumps into what Jerry was saying, trying to divide. He wants to understand the difference because it can sound so definitive. It's either this or this, da-da-da-da. Alright, two key words in verse 25. One word is live. One word is walk. Okay. Now we are in, but we are not of. Okay, so let's write in and of. Okay. You can be in and not of, but walk according to in areas down here. Okay? You agree with that? Okay. He makes the statement. If we live in the Spirit, let us walk. Okay. 1 John 1:7, so the Johannine literature, there's one more verse we didn't deal with. We're actually making progress. Johannine says, walk in the light. Walk. Walk in the light as he is in the light. As he is. Anybody getting that? Okay. So, we do live in Christ. Alright. Let's say that you live in Israel and there is you're born in Israel, you're living there during the time of, you know, Joshua and all, after that, you know, David or something. And eventually, your old nature catches up to you, and you do something you shouldn't have done, and you know you're going to get killed. And so, you leave your family, you leave your home, you leave your earthly connections, and in order to save your life, you run where? City of refuge. So you were living out here somewhere, and, you know, there's a lot of people that this happens to, so there's a lot of different places to live, isn't there? But there's only certain places that are the city of refuge. So you run into the city of refuge. And when you run in there, what happens? You're saved. the order that God has set up is that, well, if you're in, you're okay. You agree with that? Okay. So here you are, you're in, you live there for 3 or 4 years, and all of a sudden you take a walk, and you're on the edge over here, and you're looking for better, and you're following butterflies or something, and you end up out over here. All of a sudden, and of course, once you get out, maybe you even do something out here you shouldn't do. Okay. Now here's where you dwell, here's where you live, but you walked over here. You walked over there. Okay. Now in reality, you're still in, because it's where you live. You didn't pitch a tent out here. You walked out here. You found out, oh my God, the actions I'm taking are based on this realm out here. Oh, there's no hope for me. I've failed. Kill me now. Okay. You're worthy of death out there, and that's why we feel that sense of urgency. It's important to, in reality, what we do is take our place. In reality, we're in there already. But we, by faith, must take our place. You understand what I'm saying? We, by faith, take our place in Christ. All right. So, we're back in. That's where our home is now. That's where our safety is. That's where we are. All right. Now, let's say that we have a habit of strolling out here and running back, and strolling out and running out. But a whole lot of our action seems, a whole lot of our walk seems to be out here. But we live here. Is that possible? Okay, it is possible. And here's why it's possible. Because living is related to the spirit, or is related to that which is, that which is settled, that which the Father sees you as, He placed you in Christ. This is the truth. It'll always be the truth. This doesn't fade with anything that you do in your walk, unless you just continue to walk out here, and somebody's eventually going to catch you. And if you're not in the city of refuge, you die. So if you die out here, then you die. You want to die in here. You don't know if you're going to live in here, you want to die in here. So this relates to that which is, and this never changes. And you, in truth, never change. This is how God views you. I'm not talking about, what do you mean I don't change? Look at me. That's your problem. He is not preferred before you. You are preferred before you because you look at you. The Father always looks and He says, you are in my Son. You say, what do you mean I never change? You're not even included in this. He's preferred before you. You never change because to the Father, He is the same, and you're in Him. Do you get that? You're the same. He's the same, and you're in Him. So, but when I say you never change or it never changes, you say, well, it's bound to, and the devil can come and shake you up and do things because you feel like it's changed by the way you're acting or thinking, or you went with the enemy, or the enemy led you out here, whatever. But there's a covenant between the Father and the Son. And you are a partaker of that covenant in, and only in. So you must abide by faith in. That's first. If every day, in every action, your walk is out here in this realm, there is a period of time where you must embrace the truth in spite of feelings, thoughts, circumstances, demons, anything else. And this is where you learn, that He is preferred before you. This is where you learn that. And you learn to be hidden. You learn not to have a struggle of trying to be equal it is every Christian says, oh yeah, Jesus is preferred before me, Jesus before me. But in everyday actions they take and they think, they don't even consider Jesus. They don't even consider, their position in Him. They don't, this isn't, This isn't, you know, look at Paul's writings, and he's always talking to them about their problems and bringing this stuff up. We talk to people about their problems, they will quit acting so, but we prefer them before Jesus in our counsel. I mean, in all of our actions, in all of the way we proceed, and that's not, I'm not trying to condemn. It's just fact. It is very hard fact, but it is a fact. And the sooner you realize it, because once you do, once you see that from the Holy Spirit, you will be highly convicted, and you will begin to cry out, and the cross will begin to become a reality to you, because through the cross, the cross is the bridge from the old to the new, and through the cross you are not, and He is, and you will embrace that with everything, and then you cannot think, okay, you will, it won't be trying to work it up or whatever, it will so begin to be true to you that it will start affecting your walk. Alright. Now, I brought up all these other scriptures with an intent. You know, we have a hard time esteeming others better than ourselves, getting along, and this and that. We have a hard time doing that. Well, the way to do that has nothing to do with here. The way to fulfill these scriptures has nothing to do with you bringing yourself to a certain state in relationship to your brothers and sisters, or you seeing something about them or something or whatever. In fact, the way to do that has nothing to do with you and them. It has everything with Him being preferred before you. And if He's preferred before you, if He's preferred before you, He will be the one that shows up in relationship to them.
This is going back to things that you said over and over years ago, is that what we do is we learn something out of a circumstance that the Lord is trying to show us, and then instead of learning the principle behind it,
yes,
we go around trying to relearn the same circumstance over and over.
Yes.
If you learn the same principle, that if you just learn it once, then it's the same principle that affects everything. And the reason I'm saying this is because the Lord has shown me different things about selfishness. And I was trying to figure out how to be less selfish.
Right.
And then the Lord showed me that it's not you trying to learn how to be less selfish, because it's the very same principle that works with everything else. You have to reckon on the cross. You have to reckon on the body of Christ.
Right.
That's where your freedom is. That's where your deliverance is. That's where you are. It's not just in relationship to your freedom, singularly.
Right.
But that's where, if the Lord is dealing with you, and it is an honest dealing, then there has to be some sort of thing that He's showing you personally. Well, the reckoning is on the body of Christ. The reckoning is no longer on you, learn the lesson.
I remember when it began to be broken down to just one thing: selfishness or the Spirit of Christ. Before it was a million things, and then it finally came down to selfishness, which is the basic nature of the soul life of the old man, also, or Christ, which is esteems other better stuff and all this kind of stuff. And I finally got to that point, and so I saw it to be unselfish, and I found that self will become unselfish for selfish reasons. I was shocked. I was just shocked. I just said, well, what is the hope here? My God! I mean, I have even succeeded in being unselfish, and I have had my motives exposed that they are for selfish reasons. And the Lord said, that's because as long as you are, He is, and He must be preferred before you. Now, I don't want to get too far here, because I don't want to leave you hanging. I haven't really nailed this for you. Okay, let's go back. I want to take it back to the walk and to the living part, because I think it's real important that you realize that that there is that difference. And for a long time, we have been trying to place the emphasis on in. That this is very important. That your walk, regardless, we don't even want to talk about walk for a while. can bring you to a place where you don't abuse that, but it's a fact. There's a place, that's a humbling thing. That is not an easy thing. That is a humbling thing, because you are truly embracing the truth of the complete thought and concept, the saying that the Father says and holds, while you are living and looking and acting contrary, and you hate it because you truly embrace. That's not easy to do. All right, now for those that abuse that, it's real easy. They love it, you know. But they'll never know the truth. The self will never be brought in. And self can never be established. You need to get in there and get that life, and that life will instantly manifest with unself. Or you'll dry up because you can't partake of that life. Yeah. So, but in truth, most of us come here with selfish motives anyway. That's just the fact. Because we cannot advance. You know, it's just a fact. So you get to this place where there's just one whole petal and you fall there. You just fall into the ground and die. You know what I mean? You just fall there and this becomes everything too. All right. Now, but eventually, you begin to abide here and God begins to deal with you about your law because you do live. Okay? And you find yourself that you actually come from a place of identification here. He is actually being preferred before you. All right. There's not an overnight kind of thing. This, right here, with nothing added, eventually this leads to a walk in the light and a walk our law, he's using concept. But it's not two separate things in a way. We want to make it two separate things, like living and walking. And it is, but it's not, okay? You don't look at the people. First four chapters says sit. Next two chapters say walk. Okay, you ain't gonna walk till you sit for a long time. You sit way for three chapters. You sit for three chapters and you walk for two and then you stand for one. That was the key word. All right, now try this. Okay, so here I do something. Bless God, I hate this. It's really dumb, man. You know, I'm talking about my walk. I hate this, but man, it doesn't change the truth. I will not be shook. Satan, carnal mind, anything else. I am in Christ. That is, I am in, and you know, I know I'm not going to die. God's not going to kill me. The devil's not going to kill me. Nobody's going to kill me because I am in this city of refuge, and I shall not be moved. I am in Christ. And you okay. So you turn around, and you go through that process, and 2 days later, you manifest something contrary to that. You go, no. But, you know, at the same time, so you have to go through all this, no. And eventually, one day, after going through that over and over again, you realize you don't have to talk yourself into being in Christ. You're in Christ. You're there. You're in the city of refuge. God pushed you out. God, you're in Christ. You don't have to go through anything. I am in Christ. You might not even have to think that because you know that. All right. But what begins to happen after a while when you do that is your mind starts walking in the light. You begin to walk in the light. And all these scriptures that I read, you all talk about your mind. The walk, according to this, is nothing more than your mind being renewed to what is. What's settled, da 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 da. Okay. To walk contrary to that is to wrestle and try to talk yourself back into being in Christ. Obviously, you're not walking in the light. You have to convince yourself, but eventually you do convince yourself, and then you're got the victory, and you know what I mean. But I mean, if you live in the Spirit, eventually you begin to go, this is the truth, this is the way it is. And what will happen is, you'll get in circumstances, and not after you've done it will you begin to embrace this truth because of what you've done and the fear of going to hell and being separate from God and all that stuff. But this is has now become your truth. Your truth. You bear witness. You bear it. It is your truth. It's nobody else's. If it's everybody else's, it's your truth. It's the Father's truth. You are his son, and you have to become a worker together with him. your truth now. And so now, and this isn't a situation of, well, you know, I really messed up, I better, you know, put my jaw in the right place and convince myself I'm back in Christ, or get to a place where I can accept that. You have walked in this, you've messed up so many times and realized, you know, the whole deal is, I'm always there. I'm not going to go through all this stuff. This is dumb. I don't have to, because the conclusion I always come to anyway is, I'm in Christ. And that's the way the Father views me. So why go through all those gyrations? Okay, now you don't have any reasons to want to run to this city of refuge. I'm out here, I deserve death, or whatever. Because you realize in reality, you're never out there. You're all, as far as the Father's concerned, you're never out there. You're in. Now, the load of trying to adjust down here, sense realm, do this, do that, isn't even a factor. Now, new motives begin to arise in you. Motives from this vine that you're plugged into. All of a sudden, you get in a situation, and you're not afraid of being out because you're not out, you're in. You're not afraid of being left because God's going to have to look at his son and say, get off the throne and get out of the throne room now. For you to be rejected. And you know that. I mean, you are so secure, because Christ is so secure in the Father's heart, that it is so settled. But now you go, my God, you know? And there become very few issues now. I don't know how to put this to you, but there, you know, it's not all this heavy load of figuring everything, doing and responding. All of a sudden, man, you are just in. And now, you walk up to a little crossroads of the walk. And you go, hey man, Christ is my life, I am in Christ, I am a son of God, and this is the way I'm going to go. And the devil says, well, da-da-da-da-da, and scripture pops out, because your mind's been renewed with the scripture that declares the word. Folks, your mind will never be renewed by scripture. It must be the word, the complete thought concept of God, Christ. Once you get that, your mind is renewed. You cannot renew, not in the scriptural sense, you cannot renew your mind simply by putting script memorization or something. You can't do it. Pharisees memorize the scripture. The only way you can do it is by the Holy Spirit revealing the scripture, showing him, showing the saint. And you begin to embrace that as, I'm in, I'm hit, this is settled, man. I mean, it just is, it can't get any more subtle, and it won't. It'll never be any more subtle than what it was from before this thing started, the heart of the Father, boom, this is the way it is. You've said yes. Basically, all you can do is say yes, and just say it on a regular basis. Yes, Lord. Yes, 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 yes. Okay? So you've done that. Okay? Now, you're walking, come to these crossroads, and instead of messing up by going down the sense realm thing, or going to the demonic realm, or the earthly realm thing, now you go, I am in, and I'm of. And you begin to respond like a son of God, because you dare, not in a negative sense. It is your heart to bear this gospel, this light, this message. It is, and to bear it has nothing to do with how you preach. There, it has everything to do with what's working in you. Because you do not want to preach beyond what you know. What do you understand what I mean?
Well, I think that all of the front line generally will try to separate itself from life itself, trying to get itself straight. You know? And I find like a lot of people do that when they tend to mess up, or whatever you want to call it, you know, what they sin.
Right.
First tendency is to separate yourself, and matter of the body, try to straighten yourself out.
Right.
And then
I don't want to contaminate the body.
Yeah. Yeah. Or the thing is that you can't, you know, you can't really be part of the body to straighten yourself out. You know? With Christians, the thing, they've got to straighten themselves out, but what happens is, instead of their thinking is that once they straighten themselves out, they're part of the body now.
Right.
But actually what's happening is so separating themselves because the mentality is I've achieved something, so therefore I'm a high pillar in this body, they need me.
Right.
You know, or in the world, what happens is you're really people, well, I can't go forward, but I'm just straight myself out, and everything seems to go OK. rather than just in the front, but okay, this is where Jesus is on the cross, therefore it's set up. We might still have problems, but you still have Christ and keep separating yourselves from the concept of their mental point of view.
The concept of separate.
Yeah.
And that is, and the flip side of the concept of separateness is this concept that I'm talking about. He is preferred before the
Lord. Right.
Okay. We read the scriptures, let nobody be, you know, vainglorious and by strife, da 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 da, but in lowliness of mind and all that. Well, did anybody notice the surrounding area of the scripture where we're reading that Philippians 2? And then the scripture says, let this mind be in you which was also in Christ Jesus. It never refers to you. It never refers to better yourself. It says, let this mind. He that is preferred before me. It is not, see, he doesn't say, get it together with your brothers and sisters. Because you can't. If you put everybody down here in the sense realm and in the old man, people are going to use this person will power their way, this person will manipulate their way, this one will cheat their way, this one will steal their way. They're going to, you know, I'm sorry, I know, you know, there is no hope for the world apart from Christ, and that's just a fact. And if you haven't figured that out, you really need to. But there is, you know, there's nothing, man, this is going to happen, it's yucky, it is all worth throwing away, you know. But better than that, he crucified and brought us forward here if we embrace that. But to embrace that will be to embrace on him who is a certain kind of Satan. Kind, a different kind of Satan. Dealing with it, we're aware of, you know, I mean, I just want you to know that not even near aware of what you mean. I just want to let you know. But you think there's this many in and all of that. And so what we do is we begin to see this truth, okay? And we begin to apply it. So as we wrestle with this area and how to apply and know this truth, we somehow, God shows us this truth anew and fresh and in relationship to this area, and we may literally be able to apply it to that area because we understand the truth, but particularly in relationship to this area, so that anytime the devil or our flesh or anything, a circumstance like that comes up, we're not tripped up because we've seen this truth in relationship to that exact area. You understand what I'm saying? So now this is what we think is possessing the land. I want you to know this is not the land we're in that's possessing. Okay. But anyway, so what we do is then we find another area, and it's usually the most prominent, the most recent. And so we start crying out, and this is why we will, you know, and then, you know, we're going, oh, we're talking to somebody, they're saying, well, it's exactly the same truth over here, just apply it to a different area. You just go, yeah, okay, but I don't know, it's like you're resting, you're crying out, and finally, God shows you the same truth he showed you over here, but now you somehow understood it in relationship to this, and you can apply it every time if that same exact area comes up. You're never going to be tripped up because you understand, oh, I don't go by my, usually I have feelings of anger at that moment, and I don't go by my feelings, but you're thinking in relationship to that exact person who always makes me angry, and that brings forth these feelings of anger. If I ever see that person have feelings of anger, I don't go by that, I go by this. You understand what I'm saying? Now, you get angry over here over something totally different, you know what I mean? And you go, oh, now, how do I, oh, and you start, you kind of follow what I'm saying. This is a wrong process, by the way. This is not how it's supposed to work. Because in a way, you're still trying to possess this, you're still trying to keep this, and there's always going to be an open door somewhere. The real key to this thing is to begin to see you don't go by feelings, thoughts, circumstances, da-da-da-da, period, across the board, in anything. Okay, now, what if you embrace that wholeheartedly? I'm in Christ, da-da-da-da, that's the case, da-da-da-da. And you get in a certain situation over here with a brother or sister, and they make you upset or this or that, and you go, I don't go by feelings or circumstances or whatever, da-da-da-da, because I'm in Christ. And so that area just doesn't affect you because you just embrace the truth, not because you really saw it in relationship to it. And then there's this other area, maybe it's identical, but it's different. It's different enough in circumstances for you not to know that it's identical. And you go, oh, I just don't go by circumstances, better than I. You see what I'm saying? And what if there's and neither one of those, I mean, you just really don't. Okay? But what if there's some other area that you know, because, you know, your dad always backhanded you when you were young or something, and every time you get around an authority figure, there's still a tendency to go, I don't know, man, or something, you know what I mean? And you find yourself reacting that way, but it doesn't take you out of Christ. You know you're in Christ. You know, and if somebody comes up, you won't get out of your head, but you might kind of react to this, but it doesn't change the truth as far as you're concerned. So in one sense, you can say you're always here. In the other sense, you can say, I still have areas. You understand what I'm talking about? That you would like to get where what the immediate reaction is going to be Christ. That's a walk. Okay. And so our walk is improved in a certain sense. But really, the basis of the walk is where we live. And if we live in Christ, even when we're reacting, we live and we're not moved and everything. In truth, it really doesn't matter. Your reactions are only so much for physical data. I mean, it may matter because you may react and hurt somebody's feelings or something. I mean, just because, for different reasons, you know? You want it to be not just Christ here, you want it to be Christ down here. But I mean, the truth is the truth is the truth, even down here. If you just said, boom, the whole thing is, I don't know about this. Truth is the truth is the truth. Alright? But you never are satisfied. just living in this room. You go, I love his wife. I love his nature, and I want to be Jesus in every area. I want people, when they meet me, I want to meet the Lord. I want to be caught off guard in public, and I want it to be Jesus. And I want people to see it's the Lord. Not for my sake, because I'm not. I'm his. That was the Lord. Oh, Randy, let me clue you. He's preferred before me. You know what I mean? It doesn't, then, you know, there ain't no flip. There ain't no lifting up. There ain't no problem esteeming others better than yourself. First of all, he's better than anybody. You're all in the same category in that sense. But then it doesn't matter. Okay, so do you see the difference between living in Christ daily, regardless of anything, and living in Christ and not, and maybe having some areas that need some help, and living in Christ, and eventually the walk is really being filled up with Christ? It's kind of three different things. One is, I live in Christ, period. Don't look at anything else, because I am totally contrary. The second one is, I live in Christ. Sometimes you see reactions that aren't Christ, but that has not changed my stand. But many areas have been overcome. And the third one is, and this is never complete, but I live in Christ and I walk in the light. The light. The light. Remember the light? Remember all that? Terry?
Well, I've just been saying that it's God's mercy, all of these little things that we get wrapped up in here. Instead of getting wrapped up in them individually, I've been saying that how God uses that for my benefit, not necessarily to give me the victory over those individual things, but using that as a focal point just to see Christ. Instead of looking at it down here, where we normally try and fight these individual situations, God is trying to use those things to get our eyes focused on Jesus. And each time one of these things come up, it's the very same answer. Over and over, it's the very same answer. The answer never changes. And so if you see that, then pretty soon, then these things start to be less individualistic, and it's more of Christ instead of, it's kind of like having all of these things coming down here instead of fighting down here. The focal point is back to where it should be at the top, right?
And see, what we try to do is prefer him before me down here.
Yeah, but see,
it doesn't work.
Yeah, but see,
this is the only place he's going to be preferred, because this is the only place he's all and in all and anything.
Well, what I was saying is that God's mercy is using that. God's grace is using that in our behalf. I was sharing with somebody yesterday that he doesn't. God will use all of our mistakes. God will use all of the attacks of the enemy in our behalf, not necessarily to get us the victory, not necessarily to get the victory, get the devil off our back, but he uses those things in our behalf in order for us to see Jesus. And that's why he uses all of these things, not to give us individual victories, but to see Jesus. And then when you see Jesus, then you have individual victories.
Somebody else have a comment?
Before you mentioned about, I'll go back to what you were saying about in our walk, we see the truth, whatever, and we apply to one area, so we overcome that area, and we see the truth in another area, so it's all over again. Well, we think that we're just really deceptive, it's really subtle, because we think that we're lying. We are
intentioning
ourselves
in such a way.
We're
self-centered,
we're pressing on
center.
As long as our problems, pressing on
center. It really is using the word, the logos, to see.
Yes,
it really is.
It really is.
Because we're still trying to establish the sense of right.
Yes.
And that's a good point.
That's
hard to see. You know, I mean, we can only say these things and hope somebody doesn't misinterpret that or whatever, but it really is.
That's what I can just go to that, not more so the next person. So, and I've always been just hoping at this work chance we have some projects across the board. It's just really trying to go. But the other thing I want to mention is you mentioned a lot of stuff down in our walk visual circles about anger or reaction to anger or shows from here, but also you have to hear all that good stuff too that you can come to. If you want to apply the word down, the reality down in our walk, you know, take care of the problems, but then we kind of blow off the work that comes to the good stuff about us or whatever. We identify good feelings that we have, like, especially that we have a good day, you know, so basically waste kids' words and then limit about your block. All that stuff, you can't go by that stuff. You can't go by the fact that you had a really good time. That's not, you don't,
sure.
I mean, but yeah. That's just as subtle.
Sure.
That's just as subtle. You
sure.
Can't go by the fact that, you know, you got along with the first 2 days that you don't really get along with today because.
Well, that means nothing.
Yeah.
Because that's not for me.
But see, that to a carnal line, it's proof that your walk is improving. Oh, to the carnal line, see. Because I feel like I'm carnal line as well, so I know. You know, so I at least that's the way mine is worth. You know, so the good stuff's got to be, you can't go by the good stuff unless you can't go by the bad stuff. Circumstances don't go your way. So you say, well, I'll go by circumstances. If circumstances go your way, and you go, praise God, it must be getting this.
Right.
You see, and that's just as wrong. It's just as
you should still prefer the rest of the
story. Exactly.
Because if you move from this realm,
for
preferring you
for
anything, you prefer
yes.
This one.
That's right. I absolutely do. You may even think you're getting it when you see all this garbage happen, you go, I'm in Christ, I don't care. That, you know, I mean, maybe you're not getting, you know, but you're receiving all this fullness and light coming from you, but you're beginning to get that it's not you. When you see you bad, you good, you go, does it change anything? That's just that isn't even a factor to where I'm at. To me, that would be more getting it because you're getting something that's not even of you. You're not even.
Right.
I mean, it was there before you were born. Yeah, you know, I mean, that's what you're getting that is when all the stuff doesn't make you get it or not get it. Because it's not even you. It was there before you, this place was there before you ever existed. Even if you totally mess up, it doesn't change the virtue of the place. You know, all the.
Well, hopefully, thank you for sharing this today. I didn't get along with it today, so I got it. So I'm doing good, so therefore I must have it. You know. I mean, you know, that seems to be where I come from. I'm going to talk about the kings and other servants and bring them to go to the bank. That the only person that takes out the bank was the one that had to take out his wedding garments. So if you think you're doing good,
saved, you know.
Yeah.
Well, by the way, you're in him, and then everybody can.